Well, hi everyone. I'm here with a very special guest. Well, he's not really a guest. I mean, he works at Answers in Genesis. How can you be a guest? Oh, you're a guest.
I live here.
On this program that I'm doing. Well, this is Dr. Andrew Snelling. He's from Australia. He's a geologist, PhD in geology from Sydney University. Andrew, our time goes back millions of years.
Yeah.
When did I first meet you?
1976, 1977.
Wow, 1976, 1977. I didn't even leave school teaching to go full-time into the creation apologetics ministry till 1979.
That's right.
Okay, so, all right, question for you all, okay? I want you to think for a moment. We're going to talk about a special anniversary. So what anniversary or whose anniversary are we talking about?
Well, the clue is that you got a geologist here, so that narrows it down.
Okay, got a geologist.
What's a wedding anniversary?
It's not our wedding anniversary. No. That's in December, so December sometime. I'll have to remember that. I need to check that.
Yeah,
okay.
Sure.
I know it's December. I think
ask your daughters.
I think it's 48 years this year.
That sounds about right.
48. Would that be right? 90s. Anyway. Okay. No, it's not that. It's not your wedding anniversary.
No.
When was your wedding anniversary?
January 3, 1976.
Man, how do you remember those sorts of things?
I have to.
Okay. All right. So we know it's not that. Let me see. What other anniversary? It's not an anniversary of the opening of the Creation Museum or the Ark Encounter.
Well, there should be a clue because we're standing in the Creation Museum.
Look at this sign over here.
Yeah.
A clue.
That's right.
Look at that. Yep. A clue. There's the clue.
Yep.
Mount St. Helens. Okay. So on Monday, we're doing this ahead of time because on Monday, there's going to be a special article that you've written.
May 18, 1980. It's May the 40th 18, anniversary
1980.
Of what was regarded as one of the most significant geological events of the 20th century.
Mount St. Helens blew up.
Exactly. Yep.
So, Andrew, tell us what lessons we can learn. What are you going to say in this article that will be posted on Monday, which is the anniversary date?
Well, just to set the stage, 8:32 a.m. that morning, there was an earthquake and the whole north face of the mountain slid away, two-thirds of a cubic mile, the largest landslide ever witnessed. And over the next 9 hours, it was like a Hiroshima-sized atomic bomb going off every second.
That much
energy was given off.
Wow.
And geologists were staggered to what happened as a result of that eruption and its aftermath.
So can I just interrupt you for a minute?
We learn.
Just before you tell us the lessons, isn't it true that Mount St. Helens was a tiny eruption compared to eruptions in history?
Yes, it was. Compared to, say, the Yellowstone eruption, mm-hmm. it was like a firecracker going off.
Wow.
In fact, the further you go back in history, the eruptions were more frequent and larger.
Probably getting back towards the time of the flood.
Exactly.
The end of the flood.
There was a lot of eruptions during the flood, and then it tapered off. And so that's why we don't have to get worried about more big eruptions, because they're getting less and less as the Earth continues to recover from the flood, only 4,350 years ago.
Yeah.
So it takes a while for things to recover. But Mount St. Helens, when it erupted, did some significant geological things in a catastrophic way that confounded geologists who are used to thinking in slow and gradual evolutionary processes, when they think in terms of thousands or even millions of years mm-hmm. for things to happen. So, for example, the landslide went into Spirit Lake to the north side of the volcano. A huge wave of water, because the blast had destroyed the forests around there, you know, Douglas pines 200 feet thick were snapped like toothpicks. The water wave picked up those logs and dumped them in Spirit Lake. And that afternoon, it was estimated there were a million of these logs floating, but some of them were floating vertically because the root end was broken off, but it's denser. The logs taper, it was denser, and they actually sank vertically. Within 5 years, there were estimated to be 20,000 of them on the floor of Spirit Lake.
And so,
like an upright growing forest in place, because it was buried.
So if geologists didn't know what happened there and came in there and saw that, they'd probably assume this took millions of years.
Of a forest growing there.
And that's how they interpret some of those petrified logs in Yellowstone.
Exactly. Now also, the bark and the twigs were rubbed off mm-hmm. and went to the bottom of the lake and were covered up by sediments. And when it was investigated 5 years later, a scuba diver went down to check it out. There was a layer of peat 3 feet thick that formed in 5 years, and it was compositionally and texturally the same as coal beds in the eastern United States.
Well, aren't we told that usually takes millions of years?
It takes thousands, even millions of years for the peat to grow in swamps with plants growing.
According to evolutionists.
Exactly. But in a swamp peat, you don't get bark, you get lots of roots. In the peat at the bottom of Spirit Lake, you had the bark and you had no roots. And so that's exactly what you find in the coal beds. And it only took a few years to develop that peat. During the flood, you'd have the logs blast, the forest blasted away and washed into these log mats on the surface of the floodwaters. The bark would get rubbed off and it would deposit in layers that would quickly form peat that would be buried and then with the heat and pressure be transformed to coal. So the first stage of coal formation was witnessed there at Mount St. Helens.
And it doesn't take millions of years to make coal either, does it?
And, you know, one of our supporters went to the ranger station there, the observatory, and asked the ranger whether he knew about it, and he scoffed. He thought the person was crazy. But that's because the ranger wasn't aware of the eyewitness testimony or even gone down to Spirit Lake to dive down there to investigate it for himself. So every objection that's been raised about this can be easily refuted by the observational evidence.
So upright standing trees, peat formation. Okay, what else did we learn?
Well, we saw the sediments that came down. There was the landslide, there was steam eruptions that mixed with volcanic ash to make mud flows. And some of these pyroclastic flows, that's volcanic ash blasted out of the volcano, swept down the edge of the volcano, off the sides, down and deposited. In fact, the whole of Tootle River Canyon was swamped in debris and sediments up to 150 feet thick. And some of these...
So it doesn't take millions of years to form layers of sediment.
The steam was going at 80 mile an hour with these mud flows, and these layers were built. Some of them were a fraction of an inch, taking seconds. Some were up to 3 feet thick, taking several minutes. In fact, on June 12, in the evening of 1980, June 12, 1980, a 25-foot thick sequence of layers was formed in 3 hours. And a geologist examining those would see the fine bands and coarse bands alternating, and he would think that, you know, each of that represents different seasons and it takes thousands of years. But it all happened in 3 hours.
So how many layers would there be altogether with the fine layers, the coarse layers?
Thousands of them.
Thousands?
That's right.
In what, 30 feet thick, 25 feet thick?
This particular 3 hours, 25 feet thick of multiple layers. And it also had features like cross bedding and graded burying where the grain size go from coarse to fine. The geologists say normally take thousands of years.
Now, we know that it didn't take thousands or millions of years because we saw it happen, right?
And the skeptics say, oh, it's not the same. Volcanic ash is deposited differently from, say, sand and silt and mud in the layers in the walls of the Grand Canyon, for example. But those are size terms. Volcanic ash comes as sand-sized grains, silt-sized grain, clay-sized, mud-sized grains, and water, steam, sediment, water, sediment, steam mixes all act like the same as a fluid, and there's well-known scientific laws. There's been experiments repeatedly done to show that even lime mud or just mud particles can form layers very, very rapidly. It's been repeated in the laboratory many, many times, well documented.
So upright standing trees, peat formation, and then pyroclastic flows here. Pretty good.
Yeah,
see,
yeah.
Pyroclastic, no,
I
sir?
Know.
Hurricane force.
Pyro, fire, clastic, particles.
Hurricane force, steam-driven flows.
We'll teach you
Am
some
I right?
geology
yeah,
eventually.
Yeah, yeah. Forming layers, thousands of layers, quickly, within hours. Wow, there's some lessons. What about another lesson?
Well, another lesson was that on March 19, 1982, there was a steam eruption in the crater that mixed with all the volcanic ash, and a mud flow came down, and it travelled at 40 miles an hour, and within a day, it had carved out a canyon system into those sediments that had already been layered, a 1/40 scale of the Grand Canyon. It's called the Little Grand Canyon of the Tootle River.
And it did that in how long?
In just a day.
In a day.
The cliffs are over 100 feet high, and the path meanders. It's interesting. Many people say, oh, the Grand Canyon meanders, so it had to be slow and gradual. No. What happens is when you've got a rapid flow, if it meets some sort of slight disruption or a pushing back, it'll do a quick turn to get around the obstruction and keep going. So even catastrophic flows do carve out in a meandering pattern.
Now, what about people who say, oh, but that was still soft sediment, it wasn't rock?
Correct. But that's what the sceptics say, that, you know, if it happened during a flood, it would be wet and it would be soft and the walls would slump down. You wouldn't have the high cliffs that we have today. Well, here's the deal. At Mount St. Helens, it was 2 years after the sediments were laid down, so they had time to sufficiently dry out, so that when the canyon system was carved, the cliffs stood up. I believe the same has happened at Grand Canyon, that it happened within a few years of the flood finishing because of the backing up of waters in a lake behind the plateau system. When it broke through, the sediments were still soft. They weren't hard, but they were dry enough so that the cliffs stood up. The interesting thing, people say also, what about the hard rock at the bottom of the Grand Canyon, the granite? Well, at Mount St. Helens, 2 months after, so May 19, 1982, there was another mud flow that carved out a canyon 100 feet deep, Lewitt Canyon, in just a few hours, 100 foot deep, as a result of a mud flow going through solid basalt.
Basalt's a hard rock.
It's a very, very hard rock. Very, very hard rock.
I know. You've tried to hit basalt with a hammer.
And what happens is that fast-moving water like that causes vortexes that produces vacuum bubbles that implode. It's like a jackhammer hitting the rock. And we know from other observations in other situations where that process will cut through solid rock as if it was butter.
Isn't there a name for that process?
Cavitation.
Cavitation, that's right.
Technical.
So we've learnt cavitation, pyroclastic flows.
Yep.
Okay, so upright standing trees.
So we can answer all the skeptics' objections, and that will be in the article, so people, with all the references, so people will be able to use that information when they go out using these evidences to kick, when they get kickback from people who are skeptical, they can respond with the information.
So once you read this article, you'll be able to go and talk to people about, I can show you how upright standing trees could be actually formed in sediment and not take millions of years, how peat can form quickly, not take millions of years, how canyons can form, how layers can form, how mud can carve through hard rock or quickly.
And it's interesting, Ken, because years ago at Yellowstone, at Specimen Ridge, where they said there's fossil forests,
right,
they had a sign up there saying thousands of years. But after Mount St. Helens and after creationists talked about this evidence, the sign changed.
Oh, really?
Because
it can happen quickly.
There's no roots. They didn't grow there, like at Mount St. Helens.
And the petrified trees, petrification can happen quickly too.
Absolutely. Because of the hot water carrying the dissolved silica, it permeates into the wood grain and crystallises and petrifies very rapidly.
I've heard of farmers finding fence posts they put in, wooden fence posts becoming petrified.
Exactly.
So, Andrew, I don't know if this is in your article or not. I haven't read the article. I'm going to have to read the article. But it's going up Monday. I haven't seen it yet. A secret.
There's another Monday. There's another lesson.
Yeah.
What happened is after the initial eruption, which blew off the top 1,300 feet of the mountain, the pressure was released on molten material underneath, so it started oozing out and started forming a new lava dome inside the crater.
Let me ask you a question. Does that mean that's brand new rock?
Exactly.
So it'd be 0 years old?
Exactly. And there were five of those that were blasted away by subsequent eruptions, but between October 1980 and October 1986, in 6 years, 17 further lava flows formed this new crater, this new dome, which was over 1,000 feet high.
So the oldest part of that dome would be 17 years? 10 years.
Now, my colleague, Steve Austin, no, the oldest would have been 17, you're right.
Yeah.
The youngest is 10 years.
Good, I corrected Dr. Andrew Snelling. Okay, go on.
My colleague and friend, Dr. Steve Austin, went up there into the crater in 1992 and collected a sample from the last of those flows that was flowed in 1986. And in 1996, he sent it to the laboratory. The sample was only 10 years old by eyewitness testimony, and he submitted it for potassium-argon dating. That's potassium radioactively decays to argon, and the amount of argon in the rock tells you how long it's been.
That's one of those dating methods that's used by evolutionists to say, oh, these rocks are millions of years old.
And the results came back for the rock as a whole, 350,000 years, and for one of the minerals in the rock, 2.4 million years.
Doesn't that mean the dating method has problems?
Because of the assumptions. And one of those assumptions is that when the rock erupts, all the argon has already been gotten out of it, so all the argon you now measure only started accumulating after the rock cooled. And it doesn't take into account that argon is in the volcanic gases that gets trapped in the lava when it cools and crystallizes. And now, Steve has been criticized. Two things have been said about that. People have said, oh, but he used the wrong method. Well, hello, one of the people that made that criticism actually used the same method in 1966 to date volcanic rocks around the world. It's well documented in literature. Recent lava flows in Arizona, in Italy, on Hawaii, all yield old ages by the same method. And that's well documented in the second...
And he literature. Actually used that same method?
Yes, he used that
same method. Almost sounds like some of these governors across the states with the COVID-19, they're all inconsistent in the methods they apply.
Well, the other criticism is that... As the lava comes up, the conduit of volcano, bits of rock and mineral from the surrounding wall can get trapped in the lava and make the rock appear artificially old. And so they say, oh, Steve Austin didn't carefully select his sample. Well, the truth is he made a thin sections, he examined the rock under the microscope very carefully, and he actually published a photograph of the rock under the microscope to show that there were no foreign minerals or no foreign pieces of rock.
You know what, Andrew?
So he did his work meticulously well.
It's interesting. When a creationist can say, look, this dating method doesn't work, it's got these problems, the evolutionists say, oh, no, it is million, it is accurate, it does date to millions of years. There's something wrong with you. That's what they say.
The problem is that people need to realise it's not a matter of the evidence.
Right.
You know, we can talk about this evidence, but the skeptics will kick back because they have a different worldview. They believe in millions and millions of years and slow and gradual processes, and so they can't allow the evidence to conflict with their view. Because if the evidence is correct, as we are pointing out, it points to the global catastrophic flood in the days of Noah, then the Bible is right, and that means there's a creator to whom they have to obey.
It's a spiritual issue. Pressure.
People have to remember that. The evidence won't convince people. It's a work of the Holy Spirit that has to convince people and change their hearts before their minds will be changed.
So, Andrew, you have a PhD in geology from Sydney University. You've actually worked in the secular world with a company dealing with uranium deposits.
Correct.
And you've done a lot of research on dating methods. And you would claim you're a scientist, but you can't be a scientist, you're a creationist. Isn't that what the evolutionists
say? That's what they say. You can't be a real scientist if you're a creationist. What they're saying is you can't be a naturalistic scientist if you're a creationist, because naturalism is what is the belief that controls all of modern science, which doesn't allow for the supernatural intervention.
And naturalism is atheism. Yeah. I mean, that's really what it is.
And it's a belief. It's a religious belief.
It is a belief.
So it's not a matter of science versus religion. It's two histories believed about that. We've got a history given to us by an eyewitness, whereas they have a history where there are no eyewitnesses, and they've built their faith on that history, just as we build our faith on God's recorded history.
Well, you know, Bill Nye mocked at people like us. How can you people believe in radioactive decay when you don't believe in the dating methods? Wow. Radioactive decay is something you can observe and experiment with and test. But then when it comes to using that, like that potassium-argon dating on the lava dome, in regard to the past, you've got to make all sorts of assumptions about the past, and that shows you those dating methods are fallible. And that's the difference between observational science,
exactly. You
can observe radioactive decay, and historical science, interpreting things in relation to the past, we have all sorts of assumptions.
And for that, you need an eyewitness.
Yeah.
And we have a reliable witness, the God who is created, who never lies, who always tells the truth. And so that's why we can be confident. And that's why we're not surprised that the evidence in the present, when we have catastrophic geological processes like we witnessed at Mount St. Helens, we can see the effects, that point back to what we would expect to have happened during the flood, just as the Bible tells us.
Well, there we are. We want you to go and look at the article, read the article on Monday, use it as a witnessing tool. It's by Dr. Andrew Snelling, our PhD in geology, heads up our research department here at Answers in Genesis. And you know where we are right now? We're in the flood geology room of the Creation Museum.
Yep. And we're looking forward to welcoming people back soon, hopefully.
Well, hopefully soon. And as you look around this room, there's a lot of teaching in this room. Mm. We have our dinosaur skeleton over there, our Allosaur, and we even have an exhibit on natural selection over in here, and an exhibit dealing with the pre-flood world, and then we have another exhibit with the post-flood world. Yep. This is in the sea for catastrophe in the seven seas.
History.
It's just part of the seven seas right here. And when you walk out of here, you eventually walk into confusion, the Tower of Babel. So, well, Dr. Andrew Snelling, thanks for giving us all that information. We look forward to the article on Monday. It's going to be posted on the answersingenesis.org website. It'll be our lead article for that day, commemorating Mount St. Helens.
The 40th anniversary.
40th anniversary, May 18th, 1980. And you will be able to have, in summary, the lessons we can learn that actually undermine the evolutionary millions of years view of geology. Thanks, Dr. Snelling,
for
being with us today.